Good evening, everybody. It's fantastic to be here. I'm extremely humbled to have been asked to speak with you all this evening. And I'm really excited to be able to speak about something I'm incredibly passionate about, which is the Paralympic movement and how my leadership journey has led me to lead the Australian Paralympic team. I'm going to apologise in advance. My technological skills are not great, so I'm going to be popping back and forth from the computer, so hopefully nothing goes wrong, but hopefully you enjoy what I have to say this evening. So to start with, I'm just going to go through my leadership journey, because obviously every leader starts somewhere and has to build their way up. I was an athlete myself many years ago, and obviously not a high jumper. I was a gymnast. Trampolining was my sport, and I competed at 2 world championships for trampolining quite a long time ago. So that set me up well to understand the needs of athletes. But my professional career, as soon as I did a sport management degree at university, one of my first jobs was at New South Wales Rugby, and then I actually moved over to London and, as was mentioned earlier, worked at Chelsea Football Club, which was a massive eye-opener for me from a sports management point of view. Coming from being an amateur athlete to a professional business-run club was very interesting, and that's certainly kept in the back of my mind when we're working with charities and amateur sports organisations. My experience back at Chelsea was completely the opposite of what that is. When you think about the gate takings for a Premier League football game, they were only about $1 million. And someone like Jimmy Floyd Hasselbank, who was a Dutch player who played at the time I was working there, was worth £15 million a season. They have to do a lot of other things to make sure that they can afford to put a team on the field. And that's certainly not quite the same in amateur sport. So that was a great lesson for me. Some of the other things I've done, I had the great fortune to move up to Cairns with my now husband's work and worked in Far North Queensland and in the Torres Strait and some of the Indigenous communities up in the Far North Cape, helping with sports programs for the Indigenous communities. And that provided me with some amazing experiences, and it also showed me some of the most amazing areas of Australia that every single Australian should get to see at some point in their life, and to understand the culture and what goes into sport in an Indigenous community. One quick story I'll tell you about that time up in the Cape was just around the power of sport and how it brings people together. There was one particular community which had been thrown together, obviously in the 1960s or 70s, and two tribes that hated each other were in the same community. And they had two separate rugby league teams. And one of our sport officers went up there and tried to create one team. There was a Cape York Cup that was created, and they needed only one team from that particular place, and they refused to play together. And it took him 16 weeks for them to finally get both tribes to turn up to training when they realised that there wouldn't be rugby league if it wasn't actually for them playing in the one team. And that sport brought that town together. It didn't solve all the problems, but it certainly went a long way. So that's a fantastic lesson from how the power of sport, I guess. I have worked at the Australian Olympic Committee as well, which was fantastic. I worked at the Australian Youth Olympic Festival in 2009, the New South Wales Institute of Sport, which gave me some great insight into elite athletes. And then where I am now, which is probably the greatest job I can ever hope to have. I can't imagine working anywhere else, because the athletes that I work with on a daily basis at the Australian Paralympic Committee are the most inspirational, they're the strongest, most powerful examples of human endeavour, I guess, that I've ever met. And I'm very, very lucky to work where I do. So just to start off, I'm going to show you a quick video, which is from the London 2012 Games, just to illustrate how amazing Paralympic sport is.
I declare open the London 2012 Paralympic Games.
Oh. Yeah, you can be the greatest, you can be the best, you can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
And the big man is off to the races. progression. And the world's gonna know your name. How sweet it is!
The distance, you can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile. You can be a hero, you can get the gold, breaking all the records they thought would never be broken. Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. You're never gonna know if you never even try. Do it for your country, do it for your name, cause there's gonna be a day when you're sitting in the Hall of Fame.
Brendan Hall, champion, superstar, world record holder.
Petmore's got the bronze.
So that just shows you some pretty amazing performances there from Paralympic athletes, and hopefully you got goosebumps like I do. I've watched that about 100 times and I still get goosebumps every time I see it. I'll give you a very brief rundown on the APC and where we've come from and where we're going to. The interesting thing is that there's a military background behind Paralympic sport. So the original Paralympic teams came from wounded soldiers many, many, many years ago, back in the 1940s after the war. And it's amazing that we've come almost full circle here. So tonight, I'm talking to you guys. We have an amazing relationship with the Australian Defence Force, the Australian Paralympic Committee. And it's great to see that come full circle. So we've competed at every single game since 1960 in Rome, which is pretty impressive. The same as the Olympic team have competed in every games. Mainstreaming of sports began in 1998, and what mainstreaming is the Australian Paralympic Committee used to run every single Paralympic sport itself on a very, very tight budget. We ran every single sport from start to finish, and obviously that's not practical in the long run, and so mainstreaming meant that we give those sports back to the sports to run themselves. So athletics went back to the Athletics Australia, swimming to Swimming Australia, and so on. And that makes so much more sense because they know their sport back to front, and they're able to provide them a really fantastic high-performance environment and also start to integrate them in with the able-bodied athletes. Because at the end of the day, Paralympic athletes are elite athletes, whether they've got a disability or not. And that's one thing which has taken a lot of years to get to, but we're certainly finally getting to the point where people recognise that they have exactly the same needs as able-bodied athletes. We receive funding now through the Australian Sports Commission that goes directly to the sports through the Winning Edge program, and the APC is also funded through the Australian Sports Commission as well, in addition to needing to fundraise as well for the Paralympic team. We deliver both summer and winter Paralympic Games teams, and we also provide we fill the gaps. So where the sports run the high performance programs, where there are gaps in niche Paralympic knowledge, we try and fill them. So Swimming Australia or Athletics Australia, for example, may not have niche Paralympic expertise in talent identification or in research and innovation as it relates to wheelchair design or performance services. So that's specialist physiotherapy for people with cerebral palsy, for instance. Classification is also a really big part of Paralympic sport. So when you see the Paralympic Games and you see different people with different impairments lining up together, it looks very confusing. That's all part of the classification system, whereby people are classified into different classes according to their impairment type. So it's as fair as possible. They're competing against like athletes, if that makes sense. So we run all of that. Skill acquisition is becoming more and more important for us from a Paralympic point of view, and as I mentioned, research and innovation, wheelchair design, prosthetics and so on. So we can help the sporting organisations do things that they may not be able to do themselves because of lack of resources or lack of knowledge. And it's also a really important part of what we do is educating potential referrers. So referrers are those people that come into contact with people with impairments who can then share their knowledge of Paralympic sport with people that have suffered injuries, and so that they know that there's a great pathway into sport, and that despite the fact they've suffered an injury, their life's not over. There's plenty of options at how they can continue and go into sport. So that's really important. And as part of that, we have an amazing relationship with the Australian Defence Force over a number of years now, since I think 2009, when you guys had a Wounded Warrior program. We had an MOU with the ADF, and that relationship continues today, and I'll explain a little bit more about how that works. So the two things I wanted to talk to you about today are around leadership, but the two most important things that I think the Australian Paralympic team do to lead their team is around collaboration and resilience, the two most, I think, most important things. We cannot do everything on our own. We need to outsource skills of the ADF, skills of the Australian Federal Police, the skills of the Australian Institute of Sport, the sports, even the athletes. All of that takes listening to other people, learning from other people, and building that knowledge so that we can create the best possible performance environment for our athletes to compete overseas. And then resilience, and I don't think I probably need to explain resilience to you when you've seen the type of athletes that we deal with. I learn more from those athletes on a daily basis than I can probably learn from anybody else. But there's plenty to be said about resilience in a high-performance environment so that we actually do deliver on our outcomes and we don't constantly look back and think, oh gosh, I don't want that to have happened. You're constantly moving forward and it's showing resilience. So just some examples of how we collaborate in order to deliver our team. One of the single most important parts of our team are our athletes. They must be first and foremost. Without them, we don't have a team. I don't have a job, and there's absolutely no point in anything. So we've started quite recently to start a far more athlete-centric approach to our team. And the sorts of things we do, we've just, even today, had an athlete forum around transition out of sport and mental health. Mental health for athletes has become a really topical thing in the media recently. Paralympic athletes, unfortunately, are some of the highest rates of suicide when it comes to elite athletes. And when you think about it, able-bodied athletes struggle when they finish competing because they're going back into life. They're no longer an athlete. They feel they've lost their sense of identity. A Paralympic athlete has exactly the same thing, but they go back into society as a minority. And so it's even more so that we need to start protecting them and start realising that they're part of our family. And just because they're no longer competing, they gave a lot for their country, they represented their country, and we need to look after them because they're part of our family. So that's something we're working on at the moment, looking after up-and-coming athletes, current athletes, and our past athletes. And I'll talk about the mob, the concept of the mob, which is introduced prior to the Rio Games, and how we're looking after our athletes in that way. We started an athlete commission as well. As a chef de mission, I don't want to make any decision as part of the build-up and the planning for Paralympic Games where I don't actually address it with athletes and see what they think. There's going to be decisions where they can't have an input and it's just the way it is, and I'm sure there's plenty of things they'd love to have input into that I just can't let them have input into. But anything I can, it's crucial to give them that opportunity from my point of view, because if you don't have buy-in from the most important people in that team, then your leadership's probably going to fail. So that's really important. They're key to us. The coaches, the sports, the administrators, that's the next picture up there, they are incredibly important too. If I don't get buy-in from them, I've got 17 sports that have to come together as one unit for the Paralympic Games. Now, they're used to travelling to World Championships, World Cups as their own sport, worrying just about their sport. If I don't get buy-in as a whole team from all of those 17 different team managers, then it won't be a one team. We won't go over there and feel like we're connected. And as a result, I don't think we do quite as well. I think we did a really good job in Rio of bringing the team together and making sure that it didn't feel like 17 silos. It was one connected team. And the ways we do that are by bringing those coaches and those high-performance directors together regularly. And just recently, a couple of months ago, actually had Richard Mallett came along with some other people from the ADF and provided us with an amazing team-building activity. I think he scared the bejesus out of some of them, but it was a really great opportunity to get all of the key people that make our team work together, network, get to know each other, because sometimes I think I've been told by some people, oh, well, you don't have very much information about the Tokyo cycle yet, why get together? Don't get together until 2019 when you have more information. But by 2019, they've got so much more on their plate, they don't want to think about bonding and networking and becoming a team. This is the time I should be doing that. And it pays off in dividends because when I was in Rio, we had a lot of these get-togethers, which we call, we had Rio Campaign Rio in the lead-up to the Rio Games, and we're having Mission 2020 in the lead-up to the Tokyo Games. To see at the end of a day a coach who had an athlete who did not medal, they were expected to medal, which is really, really hard from a coach's point of view because I'm sure they take it on themselves, but see him debriefing with a coach from a completely different sport, from a team sport, not an individual sport, and actually helping each other get through that, that means we've succeeded because that networking 3 years prior meant that that coach had the support they needed at the right time and was supported and didn't feel like they'd failed. They could talk through it. So that's really key for us, and it goes for every single part of our headquarters staff, from physios, medical, media, all of that. If we can get them together really regularly in the lead-up, it means our team is so much more cohesive. We've got their feedback, we know that we've collaborated, and everyone is buying into the concept. External organisations like the AIS, State Institutes and Academies of Sport are critical as well because they train our athletes on a daily basis. We can't take credit for them once every 4 years and say, well, look at the Australian Paralympic team, didn't we do a good job? Because at the end of the day, we did a good job for perhaps the 2 weeks we were in Rio when these other people have done 4 years of amazing work with these athletes. So it's really critical that we work in with them. Sponsors are critical for us as well. I've just got up there an example, Optus. Optus are helping us. They've sponsored us $10 million over 10 years, which sounds like a huge amount of money, but $1 million a year really doesn't go very far. But the amazing job that they do is by value adding. They're doing some great things in the technology space. We don't have the capacity to do that. We would never have the capacity to do it. They've set up a system where, for example, some table tennis athletes whose coach is in Adelaide and that the athletes are in Melbourne, they're doing virtual reality crosses. So he can actually watch their stroke with virtual reality goggles on, so he can see exactly what they need to change and can give them real-time feedback. That's stuff we couldn't do ourselves. So to have those sponsors on board to think really big and to think about the ways in which they can try and change what we do to get a better performance at the end of the day. And then there's you guys. So the next picture is of the Australian Defence Force. And as I've said, we've worked with you guys since 2009. And it's probably little known to a lot of people within the Defence Force, the amount you guys do for us. One of the critical things is around uniform distribution. You guys are taught to be experts in logistics. And that's something we can do well, but nowhere near as well as what you can. So we, every 4 years, enlist your support to actually set up the warehouse, and we have some of your people come out, in the past it's been from the Navy, to come out and actually run that uniform distribution facility. I'll just show you a video so you know what that was about.
We're packing full team kit bags for the entire Australian Paralympic team, so that is inclusive of athletes and officials across all our sports. Most that would be packed are for sports like paratri or wheelchair, rugby, basketball, and there'd probably approximately 40 garments in those bags, and we go down for, say, an official, not specific to a sport, who'd probably sitting around 30 garments.
It's a huge process getting all the bags together. There's a huge amount of uniform that needs to be packed ahead of the Games in September, and we're really, really fortunate to have a great relationship with the Australian Defence Force, specifically the Navy. Those guys are experts in logistics and do an amazing job of pulling it all together for us and giving the manpower that we need to get it all done in time.
So at the moment I've got four of my sailors who are going around and using the picking slips that we've received from Kate, and essentially they're going through and grabbing everything on those picking slips, putting them into their trolleys, and then they're going to be packing them into the bags. Each person has their own bag and each person has their own certain sizes and everything.
So at this stage we're looking to pack around 340 bags.
We're smashing out about 94 bags a day of the luggage bags, which are the bigger ones, which is an extreme effort for these guys. They're working at about 16 bags an hour, which is excellent.
So the uniform is made up of 2x U gear for competition and for casual wear, and RM Williams have come on board to do our ceremonial wear.
I love the uniform. I think it's bold and I think it's very agreeable to the Rio climate.
We want them to be absolutely elated, to be excited at what they're opening and to feel incredibly proud that what they're going to put on will be there for Australia and the rest of the world to see. So as you can see, that relationship is really, really valuable to us. And likewise, we're working a little bit with you guys as well at the moment in the lead up to the Invictus Games and providing support and advice in the area of eventing and putting the Australian team together. So we're really excited to be able to return the favour and help you guys with advice that might help our team come Toronto and then Sydney next year, do extremely well. I'll touch on the final picture, which is actually a Qantas picture, a little bit later on, but that's just another example of a sponsor helping us out. So look, as you can see, collaboration and working together is incredibly important to us, and we certainly wouldn't be able to deliver the team that we do without a variety of different people and organisations. I'm going to briefly touch on the mob. So the mob is a concept that that Kurt Fernley and Daniela De Toro, who were our 2016 team captains for the Rio Paralympic Games, between myself and those two captains, we came up with a concept of the mob, which meant that every single Paralympic athlete needs to feel part of a family. We're all there for each other. There's a lot of athletes that go through very similar circumstances. They have similar impairments. They've been through similar issues. They've either acquired their disability or they have been born with their disability. And we just needed a way to try and connect everybody together, because every 4 years we get together, and in those intervening years we don't see each other. So we wanted to try and create that connection so that by the time we actually got to the Games, they felt like they were part of something bigger than just them. And that's where the mob was born. And as I touched on earlier, it's around also looking after our alumni. Curtis McGrath, who many of you may have heard of, fought in Afghanistan and lost both of his legs. I'll show you a video on him in a minute. He coined it extremely well. He said, look, I'm going to the Paralympic Games, but there are many, many of my friends who will never come home again, and I'm doing it for them. I'm doing it for every athlete that didn't make the team, every athlete that wants to make the team in the future, every athlete that has made the team in the past, because they've paved the way for me. And it's just a really special, sentiment, and it's actually taken off. We didn't think it would, but it's really taken off, and the athletes now are really proud of being part of the mob. Mob is obviously a term that we came up with because of its Indigenous significance, and we have checked with Indigenous leaders to make sure they were comfortable with us using that term, because it really coins exactly what we wanted to achieve, that feeling of togetherness and part of a family. Daniela De Toro is of Italian heritage, and she keeps telling me it's nothing to do with that, it's all about not messing with the mob. So there's two different ways to look at it, I guess. But it's certainly something which from the leaders of the team have found incredibly important, and why the culture for our team in Rio was so good. So resilience is the second part that I wanted to talk to you about today. And it's pretty obvious that the athletes that we deal with on a daily basis are 177 incredibly resilient people who have gone through things that you and I would never want to go through, but they are the most positive role models for people with disability and positive people for, you know, positive role models for all Australians. I don't think it matters if you've got a disability or not. Their mentality and the way they go about their lives and the way they represent Australia is something which is pretty impressive. So I just thought I'd start off with a couple of pictures there just to show you the before and after. So the picture up the top left there is Ellie Cole. She lost her leg when she was 2. She had cancer, and she's gone on to win multiple gold medals for Australia in swimming. She's the most amazingly positive person you could ever meet. Curtis McGrath, many of you may be aware of Curtis, who fought in Afghanistan and then went on to win a gold medal at the Paralympic Games in Rio in canoe. One thing I will mention, which is quite confronting, I guess, to think about, but Curtis is almost a good example of that. There are going to be people on our team in Tokyo who have not yet acquired their injury. And that's quite confronting to think about. We had one swimmer in Rio who was a swimmer prior to her accident, but in 2014, she fell off a balcony and had her leg amputated as a result. And 2 years later, she was on a Paralympic team. So it just shows you how people can be fast-tracked, but it also shows you how, you never know what's going to happen, you never know what's around the corner, but those who have had something happen to them have chosen to be really positive about it and drive their passion in sport on the world stage. The photo just down on the bottom left is of Daniel Michel, and he is a boccia athlete, and he has muscular dystrophy. And I guess the other thing which is quite confronting as well is that Daniel's illness is not going to get better, it's only going to get worse. And we really hope that he gets to Tokyo, but this is something we're dealing with on a daily basis with the group of athletes that we work with. They've had incredibly awful injuries or illnesses that have led to their impairments, but the positivity and the way that they turn their life around is just incredible to watch. And then the final person there is Ahmed Kelly. Now, Ahmed was picked up in an orphanage in Baghdad when he was a child, and partial arms and partial legs as a result of, it was a birth defect, but probably because of chemical warfare. His brother was exactly the same, and he was picked up by an Australian nun who adopted them both and brought them home to Australia. He's the Aussiest guy you could meet now. He's just the most amazingly positive person, and he has swum for Australia twice now at 2 Paralympic Games. So I just wanted to show you, I guess, the breadth of people we're dealing with. You've got people that have acquired their injury in terms of Ellie and Dan and some people that were born with them, like Ahmed. So incredibly resilient people. So what do we learn from them? So obviously resilience, from my point of view, it's the capacity to recover quickly from some kind of difficulty. And the better you do that, the better you can perform. So I believe learning from others and learning from other people's mistakes is critical. And I'll give you some examples of that. In the media, Rio was touted as being a complete disaster. And if you'd listened to everything the media said, we were going to have the worst games we had ever had. But you couldn't have been further from the truth. It was a fantastic games. The Brazilian people are not the best planners in the world. If they were more laid back, they'd be horizontal all the time. But they came to the fore and they did an amazing job when we were over there. But we planned. We knew that it was going to be a little bit chaotic. So part of being resilient is planning and making sure that you're as prepared as you can for any eventuality. And you can't plan for everything, but if you've planned to know how you're going to respond to any eventuality, even if you can't fix it straight away, that's going to lead to success in the long run. Flexibility, it was really important in Brazil because they didn't plan things, because 2 days before they were supposed to have the village open, it still wasn't open, and there were no towels in half the rooms, and the accessible bathrooms, when we turned up, had 60 centimetre wide door frames when the wheelchairs were 65 centimetres wide. So things like that you just need to be prepared for and need to be flexible. But the athletes that we have are so used to having to deal with a completely inflexible world that when we got there, it wasn't a problem. It absolutely didn't. It didn't impact them at all. And in many ways, they said, we thought it was going to be far worse than this, which is a great spot to be in. And it's probably why they did so well, because they were planning for chaos and it was absolutely fine when they got there. Innovation's another thing as well. So I spoke about Qantas and our relationship with Qantas as a sponsor. One of the things we pick up with Paralympic athletes is their ability to recover after long-haul flights. So people with spinal cord injury, people with cerebral palsy, those people, when they get on flight, you and I get on a flight and find it incredibly difficult to keep our eyes open when we get to the other end and our body feels like it's been through the wars. Think about having an impairment, which also means that you can't get up in the middle of the flight. You can't go for a walk and stretch your legs. You're stuck in the chair for the entire 14-hour flight, and then you have to have a layover, and then you're back on the plane again for another 8 hours. It's not ideal. So Qantas and the APC and the AIS got together to actually come up with a customised seat for every single athlete with high needs. So athletes that were at high risk of having things like deep vein thrombosis or not recovering at the other end, we created a special seat for them that fit straight into a Qantas seat, and it was specially moulded to their body so that when they sat down, any pressure points, any pressure sores they might normally have suffered didn't happen quite as much. So by the time they got to Rio, they felt fresh. There was still a bit of jet lag, but they certainly weren't anywhere near as in as bad a shape as they could have been had they not had that. So it's just thinking outside the box and making sure that we've done every single thing we can possible to make sure that their environment when they get there or in the journey is giving them the best possible chance of success. Moving forward and uniting the team. So I'm a big believer of not looking backwards. You look backwards to learn, but you don't look backwards and dwell on it. That's the last thing you need to do. We had a situation where on day two of athletes arriving in the village, we had what I describe as probably the worst case scenario. We had a failed doping test. And that's, from a sport point of view, that is, it's awful. It throws the team into disarray. You don't expect it because you do all the planning in the world. You work with ASADA. You make sure athletes are educated. But at the end of the day, athletes are the ones that are responsible for what they put into their bodies. And if they've chosen to do the wrong thing, we can't do a thing about it. But we have to deal with it as a team. And that had the potential to derail the entire cycling team's campaign. But we chose to put some things in place where we got the team together, had a big open discussion about how we were going to deal with that, how everyone was feeling, whether they were angry at the person, whether they were sad, they wanted to know how he was, where he was going home. We dealt with all of that in one room within 2 hour period, and at the end of that said, right, we're moving on. This is behind us. We've dealt with it. And that team went on to win multiple gold medals and silver medals and bronze medals at those games when it had the potential to completely derail their entire campaign. So that was just a good example of them being resilient in the face of something that they didn't expect. No one expected that to happen, but they were able to persevere. As a leader, I think reducing the stress on your team is really imperative. I have two small children, and when I was over in Rio, I think it was about day 10, and I rang my husband and was speaking to them on the phone, and my five-year-old wouldn't come to the phone. And finally, when he did, he said, Mummy, don't you want to be part of this family anymore? Because I'd been away for so long. And that cut me pretty badly. And I'm sure there were plenty of other people who were in similar situations. We were away for 5 weeks. And I'm sure in what you guys do, you're away for even longer. And that's really hard to try and manage family and manage how you're going to deal with that. But as a leader, you need to be able to know who you can lean on and talk to about those situations and so that it doesn't impact what you're doing on a daily basis. Because the team still need me. I can't fall apart and go, I'm going home, that's it. My five-year-old's disowned me. I give up. That's not going to work. So it's a case of coming up with a strategy to know who you can vent to, get it off your chest, organise to ring home a little bit more often, and then get on with the job and make sure that it's like that whole duck in the water thing. You know, you might be underneath with the duck paddling away really fiercely, but along the top, I'm just sailing away as if nothing's happened. And that's really important because creating a sense of calm in a Paralympic village is really, really important for those athletes. They're concentrating on their competition, and if you've got people panicking in headquarters around administrative things or things from home, then it's not going to help the athletes, and that's why we're there, to help them perform at their best. And I guess that goes into the recognition of your weaknesses and developing coping strategies as well. So look, that's pretty much where, if actually I didn't show you the Curtis McGrath video. Did you want me to show you Curtis McGrath's video. I think it might resonate with some of you guys. I knew I'd forget something.
I knew straight away that my injuries were that severe that I will never walk on my own legs again. And in that moment, that's when I realised that I wanted to be in the Paralympics. And I said to the guys, you guys will see me in the Paralympics. In Afghanistan, I was a combat engineer. It was on a clearance patrol of an unoccupied police checkpoint, and I stepped straight on top of the improvised explosive device. I don't remember doing cartwheels or backflips or anything like that. I remember looking up, I was on my back, it was dark, it was dusty. I got up on my elbows and I looked down and my legs are gone. They talk about in Afghanistan or any battlefield situation now that the golden hour, they try and get you to a high level hospital as soon as possible. I was pretty much on that hour getting to the hospital, and I passed out in the helicopter on the way to the hospital from blood loss. So that's, you know, quite a good indication of how close it was. I'd always been involved in sport in one way or another, whether it was at school or in the army or, you know, in my own time, and I wanted to do something in that avenue, and if I had picked the right sport, I believed I could go to the top. Representing my country at a world championships is quite an amazing feeling, to be able to put on the green and gold and really represent something that I believed in. It was a really great feeling to be able to step on top of the podium on my first World Champs, and 2 years to the, pretty much to the day, being injured and helping fulfill that promise that I made on the stretcher. So I guess being able to compete for Australia is very similar to being overseas, but in the sense of sometimes guys don't come back from Afghanistan or conflict, and I've been given a second chance, and you've got to be able to believe in yourself to know that you have the ability to achieve what you want and what is possible. Might not seem possible at the time, but as long as you have that belief, you'll get there. The belief in myself and my ability is absolute, but I need you to believe in me too. Without the support of generous Australians just like you, I won't get a second chance to fight for my country. Donate now and help Australia's Paralympic athletes get to Rio. Believe, and together, we're invincible.
So yeah, Curtis is a pretty amazing Aussie, and you guys should all be proud that he's part of your family, but he's equally part of our family as well. And I think, having him representing Australia on the world stage is great for the Defence Force, and it's great for the Australian Paralympic Committee. So I'm pleased you were able to see that. I'm going to wrap it up quickly now and just show you one final video around Dylan Alcott. And many of you might have seen him win gold or 2 gold medals at the Rio Games in wheelchair tennis. I wanted to show you this video too, because the message he gives to young kids who've got disability or people with disabilities is pretty powerful. Our athletes have the most amazing resilience, but they're also people that can teach others how to take things that happen to you in life and make them into something good, even if they seem really bad at the time. I'll leave you with this final video, and thank you so much for having me this evening. It's been great talking to you. I think actually there's some questions afterwards, but I'll just leave you with this video.
I'm so proud to be a Paralympian. Travel the world and play sport and meet people that were just like me. I just love representing my country, playing sport. It means everything to me because the Paralympics is a beautiful thing. I'm proud to have a disability because I love my life just how it is. And for any kid out there that is having a tough time, you know, be proud about the fact that you've got a disability, because everybody wants to be different, whether it's your job, the clothes you wear, and what better way to be different than have a disability, as long as you can embrace it and go out there and kill it in life.
Everybody was